Tantor Audio presents ISIS Exposed, Beheadings, Slavery, and the Hellish Reality of Radical Islam by Erick Stakelbeck. Narrated by Tom Perkins. Prologue, The Islamic State of Minnesota. Welcome to Little Mogadishu. I motioned out the car window toward a steady procession of Somali women covered in Islamic garb, walking up and down the street, carrying shopping bags. "This must be it," my cameraman Ian agreed. We pulled over to get the lay of the land. Groups of men congregated outside a gritty strip of Somali-owned businesses on one side of the street, while Riverside Plaza, a densely packed cluster of high-rise apartment buildings, populated mainly by low-income immigrants from Somalia, occupied the other side. As Ian and I strolled the streets of Cedar Riverside, or Little Mogadishu, as it's known to locals, capturing footage for a series of TV reports, I wondered how many Minnesotans realize that this neighborhood in the shadow of downtown Minneapolis was the center of the nation's largest concentration of Somalis, or that the Twin Cities, Minneapolis and neighboring St. Paul, were home to over 100,000 Somalis, more than any metropolitan area in North America. More important, I wondered how many Americans knew that these two cities nestled in the frozen tundra of the upper Midwest, in a prosperous state that annually ranks among the nation's best for quality of life, had become the number one terrorist breeding ground in the United States, beating out New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, and even Dearborn, Michigan, home to the country's largest Arab-American population and a known hotbed of support for the terror group Hezbollah. Frosty Minneapolis-St. Paul holds the dubious distinction of being America's Jihad Central, thanks in no small part to its large Somali immigrant communities and neighborhoods like Little Mogadishu, which have proven fertile ground for terrorist recruiters. Since 2007, dozens of young Somali men and women from the Twin Cities have used their U.S. passports to travel overseas and join Islamic terrorist organizations. The first wave departed for Somalia to join the al-Qaeda-linked group Al-Shabaab. Most never returned home, and some have been confirmed dead, including a Minneapolis man named Shirwa Ahmed, who became the first successful American suicide bomber when he blew himself up as part of a coordinated attack in northern Somalia that killed 30 people in October 2008. The destination of choice for aspiring mujahideen, holy warriors, from Minnesota changed around 2012 as the Syrian civil war became the prime magnet for jihadists around the world. One organization in particular has captured their imagination and allegiance in an unprecedented way: the Islamic State of Iraq and al-Sham, or ISIS. Also sometimes referred to as ISIL, or the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, and by the Arabic moniker Daesh, the terror group originally grew out of an al-Qaeda franchise that had fought against U.S. forces in Iraq. Employing a lethal mix of brutal violence, battlefield prowess, fanatical ideology, and social media savvy, ISIS blazed its way across large swaths of Syria and Iraq in rapid and stunning fashion, on its way to declaring a caliphate, or Islamic State. As we'll hear throughout this book, ISIS may be the most powerful terrorist movement in history, boasting tens of thousands of foot soldiers, and countless more sympathizers, and threatening not only the Middle East, but also the United States and Europe, in ways that are profound and unprecedented. Look no further than Minneapolis and St. Paul. As of this writing, at least 15 residents of the Twin Cities reportedly have traveled to the Middle East to join ISIS. All but one of these American terrorists, a 33-year-old African-American convert named Douglas McCain, who was killed fighting alongside the group in Syria in August 2014, were of Somali descent. The list includes Abdirahman Muhammad, a 29-year-old Minneapolis resident who died in the same battle as McCain. Before leaving Minnesota to join ISIS, Muhammad, who was the father of 9 children, worked at Minneapolis-St. Paul International Airport, where he cleaned jetliners for Delta Airlines. Muhammad reportedly had unfettered access to jetliners at the airport, which handles 90,000 passengers a day. He also had access to the tarmac and special security clearance to other parts of the airport. How nice. If Muhammad was able to obtain not only a job, but security clearances at a major American airport, one wonders how many more aspiring ISIS terrorists have been able to do the same. As I sat at an outdoor cafe in the shadow of Little Mogadishu with Bob Fletcher, who for 16 years served as sheriff of Ramsey County, which includes the city of St. Paul, he explained how terror recruiters have made inroads into the local Somali community. Fletcher retired from the St. Paul Police Force in 2013 and now heads the Center for Somalia History Studies, where he works with Somali community leaders to counter Islamic radicalization in their neighborhoods. He told me that the emergence of ISIS and its declaration of a new caliphate in the heart of the Middle East has been a game changer. What's happened is that since July of 2012, we haven't had any kids leave to go join al-Shabaab. But we have had several leave now to go join ISIS. And the reason is that ISIS controls land. They control cities. They are in a position to be able to recruit differently than al-Shabaab. Al-Shabaab, all they have to promise is, come join us in the jungles while we ambush and plot our terrorist attacks. But what ISIS is selling now is the opportunity to build something, to build a new society, and that is very, very exciting for a lot of kids, to be a part of something new and special, to have some sense of self-worth. In June 2014, a 20-year-old man and a 19-year-old woman, both Somali-Americans who attended the Al-Farouq Youth and Family Center Mosque in the Minneapolis suburb of Bloomington, disappeared. They are now thought to be in Syria. Interestingly enough, the same mosque was also frequented by an Egyptian-American radical named Amir Mishal, who allegedly preached jihad to young Somalis there. Mishal was no stranger to Somalia, a fact that may have helped him in his interactions with young Somali-Americans at Al-Farouq. In 2007, he was arrested and questioned by counterterrorism agents in Kenya and accused of having received weapons training in an Al-Qaeda camp and of serving as a translator for the terrorist group's leaders in Somalia. The charges against Mishal were eventually dropped, and he seems to have kept a low profile, until resurfacing in Minnesota sporting a BMW and plenty of cash, according to his reputation around the Al-Farouq Mosque. Whether the two missing young people came under Mishal's influence is unclear. Once the mosque's leadership learned of his extremist views, it contacted local police and obtained a no-trespassing order, essentially banning him from Al-Farouq. And as of this writing, Mishal's whereabouts are unknown. Whether he was working as a terror recruiter or not, some have even speculated that he may have been an FBI mole, Mishal's alleged activities at Al-Farouq show, at the very least, how a charismatic radical can influence impressionable young minds. In his intensive work with the Somali community, former Ramsey County Sheriff Fletcher has heard story after story of how young Twin Cities Somalis were lured to jihad overseas, to Syria and elsewhere. He provided me a fascinating and chilling first-hand glimpse of how the terrorist recruitment process works for ISIS and other Islamic terror groups on American soil. There is no question that the internet is one of the primary mediums to get a kid hooked. It is the gateway drug. But there needs to be some real people on the ground that reinforce what they are hearing on the internet. There needs to be a person that touches them on a personal level, what I refer to as the guide. There is going to be a person that physically gets in touch with these kids, and helps facilitate that travel to the Islamic State. Recruits need to procure travel documents. They need to raise money, usually somewhere in the area of $4,000 to $5,000, to help facilitate all the travel that takes place. And plus, these kids want to have money when they get there. And they need to make sure someone is purchasing the tickets. They need a driver and a facilitator to get them to the airport. So there is, I don't like to use the word team, but there is an organization that makes this happen. But usually there is one principal person that I call the guide that can take this person in this radicalized ideological state and guide them to Syria or wherever it might be. And, of course, there are people in the Middle East that are constantly feeding and supporting this decision. Somalis first began arriving in the United States in the early 1990s, thanks to a taxpayer-funded refugee resettlement program run by the State Department. In my 2011 book, The Terrorist Next Door, I described how tens of thousands of Somali Muslims, with the U.S. government's help, have left the chaos of their homeland over the past few decades and settled in places such as Nashville, Boston, San Diego, Columbus, Ohio, Portland, Maine, and especially the Twin Cities. The exodus is not hard to explain. Somalia has had no functioning central government since 1991 and is among the most dangerous countries in the world, as the 1993 Black Hawk Down incident, in which 19 U.S. servicemen were killed in a raging gun battle against warlords and jihadists in the capital city of Mogadishu, showed so vividly. It's also a hotbed for Islamic terrorism, with the al-Qaeda-linked al-Shabaab perpetrating acts of horrific carnage not only inside Somalia, but in neighboring Kenya, where al-Shabaab terrorists laid siege to an upscale Nairobi shopping mall for 4 days in September 2013. Murdering 67 people, including several Western tourists. Many Somali Americans are undoubtedly grateful to have escaped the chaos of their homeland and started a new life in the United States. But in reporting extensively since 2008 on the growth of Islamic radicalism in Somali American communities throughout the U.S., I have found time and again that failure to assimilate, and in some cases a lack of any desire to do so, is a major issue for a significant chunk of Somali immigrants. For an unemployed, isolated 19-year-old Somali with little education who doesn't feel quite at home in the United States, the lure of being a gun-toting jihadi rock star in the Islamic State and a supposed champion and defender of Muslims around the world can be quite appealing. But ISIS doesn't attract just high school dropouts and pot-smoking knuckleheads. Omar Jamal, a longtime Somali community activist based in the Twin Cities, told me that while the Islamic State does indeed target the confused, lost identity kids and high school dropout types, he had come to realize that even an A student in universities and colleges is vulnerable to ISIS's powerful propaganda machine. It has been very successful. Kids are responding to it. The attraction is a very strict, ideological-driven message and indoctrination process. Kids are led to believe they are part of a bigger mission, something much bigger than them. They feel grandiose. Department of Homeland Security Chief Jed Johnson paid a visit to Little Mogadishu in November 2014. Meeting with local and state law enforcement and community leaders to devise strategies to combat violent extremism among Twin Cities residents. Unfortunately, branding the problem of Islamic terrorism with the vague, evasive label of violent extremism is getting off on the wrong foot. To be crystal clear, the root cause of the virtual terror pipeline from Minnesota to the Islamic State is a powerful, well-defined Islamic jihadist ideology that, as we'll hear throughout this book, resonates among a significant number of Muslims of all races, nationalities, education levels, and socioeconomic backgrounds. ISIS's influence in the United States can be felt not only among the Somali communities of the Twin Cities, or in the lone wolf terrorist attacks it has inspired in places such as Oklahoma and New York City, but among radicalized young Muslims across the country, all interconnected by a manic ISIS social media campaign for which the group and its supporters blast out some 90 tweets per minute. Twitter is only one means by which ISIS reaches an English-speaking American audience with its message. The crown jewels of its multimedia onslaught are its propaganda videos, which feature ultra-slick production values, reminiscent of a Hollywood action flick. One ISIS video released in November 2014, featuring the gruesome beheadings of American aid worker Peter Kassig and 22 captured Syrian soldiers, had an estimated equipment cost of $200,000, used multiple takes, and took between 4 and 6 hours to film. Needless to say, the days of Osama bin Laden staring into a single camera and droning on in Arabic for hours are long gone. ISIS has single-handedly revolutionized jihadi multimedia in an ambitious effort to appeal to Western Muslims, the same American and European recruits that reportedly crave Snickers, Pringles, and Red Bulls upon their arrival to the rugged Islamic State. Take, for instance, ISIS's magnum opus, a graphic 55-minute documentary entitled Flames of War that debuted on jihadi websites in September 2014. The film features an ISIS fighter speaking in American-accented English. In one scene, he presides over captured Syrian soldiers as they dig their own graves. As Ryan Morrow of the Clarion Project describes, "The film utilizes romantic imagery carefully crafted to appeal to dissatisfied and alienated young men, replete with explosions, tanks, and self-described mujahideen winning battles. Anti-American rhetoric provides the voiceover to stop-motion and slow-motion action sequences. The use of special effects, such as bullet time, is interspersed with newsreel footage. This up-to-date, sophisticated cinematography, combined with the bloodthirsty message, makes the film Flames of War reminiscent of Hitler propagandist Leni Riefenstahl's 1935 film Triumph of the Will." The decision to make an American the face of a high-profile project such as Flames of War was a stroke of strategic brilliance by ISIS that surely did not go unnoticed in the jihadi underground of the United States. The message of the film is unmistakable. Our movement knows no racial, ethnic, or national boundaries. It does not matter where you are from or what language you speak. Unlike America, the Islamic State does not discriminate. My American brothers, you too can rise in the ranks, slaughter the unbelievers and pagans, avenge Islam, and be among the founding fathers of a new caliphate that will one day rule the world. You will become legend. Join us. ISIS really does know no boundaries. One of the most influential spiritual authorities inspiring ISIS fighters is based not in Raqqa or Fallujah, but in the Midwestern United States. According to a study by the London-based International Center for the Study of Radicalization and Political Violence, some 60% of foreign fighters in Syria follow a Dearborn, Michigan-based imam named Sheikh Ahmad Musa Jibril on Twitter. The report found that Jibril is playing a very subtle game. He does not openly incite his followers to violence, nor does he explicitly encourage them to join the Syrian jihad. Instead, he adopts the role of a cheerleader, supporting the principles of armed opposition to Syrian dictator Bashar al-Assad, often in highly emotive terms, while employing extremely charged religious or sectarian idioms. At the time of this writing, Jibril, who is in his early 40s, had upwards of 245,000 likes on Facebook and over 26,000 followers on Twitter. He has spent 6 years in federal prison for crimes including money laundering, tax evasion, and trying to bribe a juror, and was reportedly banned from one Michigan mosque for urging his followers to kill non-Muslims. Upon his release from prison in 2012, Jibril quickly became a favorite among young Western jihadis and has even interacted directly with foreign fighters in Syria via Twitter. U.S. intelligence agencies are undoubtedly aware of Jibril's influence. He's subject to restrictive bail conditions that limit his movements, but he remains a free man, reportedly living in his father's Dearborn bungalow in the shadow of Detroit. Jibril's output on social media has dipped with increased scrutiny of his activities, but other American citizens are eager to spread the ISIS message. Consider the case of a 29-year-old single mother named Heather Kaufman. Kaufman, who lived with her parents and 7-year-old son in rural Henrico County, Virginia, was arrested by federal agents in November 2014 and charged with making false statements to the FBI about her connections to ISIS. According to an FBI affidavit, she posted pro-ISIS material on Facebook under various accounts and tried to help an undercover FBI agent facilitate a fictional Islamist sympathizer's travel to the Islamic State. If you're surprised that a single mom living with her parents in rural Virginia would convert to Islam and enter the dark world of ISIS, don't be. As we'll hear in Chapter 4, the ideology and triumphs of the fledgling Islamic State have resonated with a host of troubled men and women throughout America who are not repelled by, but drawn to, its gleeful sadism and massive success. ISIS is not just a movement. It is an event. In just a few years of existence, ISIS has upended the geography of the Middle East, drawn America back into the region, and quite possibly changed the course of world history in the process. It is a growing global phenomenon that profoundly threatens America from within and without. And it is just getting started. Chapter 1. The Caliphate Returns. We're talking about Egypt today, but in a few months, everybody will be talking about Iraq. Trust me. It was mid-August 2013, and as we chatted in the green room of Fox News Channel's Washington, D.C. Bureau, a friend who is a decorated U.S. military veteran and had spent significant time in Iraq throughout that year was providing an ominous glimpse of things to come. "Iraq is out of control right now, and no one is even paying attention," he lamented. "We left, but the jihadists didn't." At the time of our conversation, the major story in the Middle East was the Second Egyptian Revolution and the demise of Mohamed Morsi's Muslim Brotherhood regime. Iraq had largely disappeared from the headlines despite a horrific wave of violence that commenced practically from the moment U.S. forces withdrew in December 2011. Most of the bloodshed was carried out by an ultra-violent terror group called the Islamic State of Iraq and al-Sham, Syria, otherwise known as ISIS, that would soon, through an unprecedented campaign of conquest and carnage, make Iraq the biggest story in the world once again, just as my friend was predicting. ISIS, or the Islamic State, is more than just a terrorist organization. It is a fully-fledged terrorist army boasting some 35,000 battle-hardened jihadists and controlling roughly 35,000 square miles of territory across vast swaths of Syria and Iraq, smack dab in the middle of the Middle East. To put it in perspective, that's an area that's been described as roughly the size of Jordan or the state of Indiana. It is home to some 8 million unfortunate souls living under ISIS's sadistic rule. ISIS and its followers are adherents of jihadist Salafism, the most extreme and violent interpretation of Islam, and the ideology of choice for Sunni Islamic terrorists. Salafi jihadists despise the West, modeling themselves after Islam's prophet Muhammad and his earliest followers in the 7th century Arabian desert. In the modern era, this worldview has translated into the merciless application of Islamic Sharia law in all areas under ISIS control. As we'll examine in Chapter 2, public beheadings, amputations, crucifixions, sexual slavery, and slave trading are all normal features of life in the Islamic State Caliphate. Religious minorities and women have particularly precarious positions in ISIS's Sharia society. They're subjected to mass persecution and second-class citizen status in places such as Raqqa, Syria, the de facto capital of the Islamic State. To say that ISIS's emergence has captured the attention of Islamists worldwide would be an understatement. The prospect of a reborn Islamic superpower dominating the world stage has loomed large in the imaginations of Muslim radicals for almost a century. Ever since the last caliphate came to an end in 1924, after the collapse of the Turkish-led Ottoman Empire, Islamists great and small have pined for its return. So, needless to say, when ISIS announced the reestablishment of the Caliphate, or Islamic State, on June 29, 2014, the news sent shockwaves throughout the Muslim world. Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi was declared the Caliph, or political and spiritual leader of all Muslims worldwide, and demanded their allegiance, a move that was met with disapproval in many Islamic corners. In many cases, not out of opposition to a caliphate, but to ISIS's presuming to declare and claiming to lead it, but embraced in others. Al-Baghdadi had the audacity, and with ISIS's military prowess and territorial gains the means, to do what Al-Qaeda, the Muslim Brotherhood, Hizb ut-Tahrir, the Iranian regime, and virtually every prominent radical Islamic entity has dreamed of doing for the past 90 years. Regardless of their tactical and even theological differences, Shia Iran, for instance, seeks more of an imamate with an Iranian ayatollah at the helm, all radical Islamist organizations share the ultimate goal of reestablishing a caliphate, or pan-Islamic superstate, that will confront Israel and the West and return Islam to its former glory days. This grand, borderless coalition of Islamic nations governed by Sharia law would ideally be united politically, economically, and militarily, control a large share of the world's oil supply, and boast nuclear capability. A formidable foe without question, and one with big shoes to fill, historically. Under the Umayyad Caliphate, the second of the four major caliphates after Muhammad's death in 632 AD, the Muslim world empire reached its zenith. Between 661 and 750 AD, the Umayyads, whose capital was Damascus, ruled over 5 million square miles of contiguous land, including Spain and Portugal, rebranded Al-Andalus by their Muslim conquerors, and drove into central France before being repelled by the armies of Frankish warrior Charles Martel. Despite the setback in France, the caliphate continued its advance elsewhere. The island of Sicily eventually came under Islamic control, and Muslim armies launched frequent raids into southern Italy, even plundering suburban Rome in 846 AD. These were only the beginnings of a long struggle between Europe and Islam that only intensified under the Ottomans, and still goes on today, albeit in a different form, as we'll hear in chapters 6 and 7. The Ottoman Caliphate was established in 1571, and at its height encompassed most of the Middle East, North Africa, and the Caucasus, not to mention a large chunk of southeastern Europe, including Greece, Romania, Bulgaria, Albania, the former Yugoslavia, and parts of modern-day Hungary. The Ottoman Turks even reached the gates of Vienna twice before being turned back. Yet by the dawn of the 20th century, the Ottoman Empire had declined to the point that it was known as the sick man of Europe. Its caliphate gradually shrank in size and influence and was ultimately abolished by the secular Turkish ruler Mustafa Kemal Atatürk in 1924. The Muslim Brotherhood was founded in Egypt 4 years later as a direct response to the dissolution of the Caliphate, an event the brothers and their founder, Hassan al-Banna, considered a catastrophe. But the Brotherhood's slow and steady incremental strategy for reviving the Caliphate was insufficient for al-Qaeda and other more impetuous Brotherhood offshoots that broke away from the brothership with the goal of establishing a sprawling Islamic state, stretching from the Himalayas in the east to the Atlantic Ocean in the west through violent jihad. Finally, ISIS took the al-Qaeda formula, added tens of thousands of foot soldiers and heavy weaponry, and ran with it, succeeding where AQ and the Brotherhood had failed, and violently imposing an Islamic state across a large area of Iraq and Syria, the heartland of the caliphates of old. Compared to the Umayyad and the Ottoman, the self-declared ISIS caliphate is tiny. But those previous caliphates weren't built in a day either. The ultimate long-term goal of ISIS, as of its predecessors, is to expand its current mini-empire to the four corners of the earth, imposing Islamic Sharia law on all mankind, and either slaughtering those who do not comply, or forcing them to live a humiliating second-class existence as zimmis. Of course, given ISIS's track record of wholesale massacres in the areas that it has conquered thus far, there would likely be few people left to zimify. Another important aspect of the Islamist vision is that all areas, including Israel and European nations such as Spain, that were ever part of the caliphate at some point in history, are still considered Muslim land and must be brought back into the fold through violent jihad if necessary. On that, there can be no compromise. While global domination is the end game, in the short term, ISIS will settle for expanding the current borders of the Islamic State into the countries in its immediate backyard, Jordan, Lebanon, Saudi Arabia, and the remaining areas of Iraq and Syria that it has not yet conquered, including the big prizes of Baghdad and Damascus. In ISIS's vision, assaults on Israel and the hated Shia stronghold of Iran would also come at some point, followed by forays into North Africa and South Asia. Does that sound like an unlikely scenario? It may seem that way, but it's not impossible in today's wildly unstable Middle East. As recently as November 2010, just before the first stirrings of the Arab Spring in Tunisia, few foresaw the toppling of secular Arab strongmen whose iron-fisted regimes had ruled for decades. Much easier to predict, unfortunately, were the radical Islamic regimes that would follow them. Who would have predicted that two massive revolutions would engulf Egypt, the most populous and influential Arab Muslim nation, in the span of just 2 years? And what about ISIS's lightning seizure of Mosul, Iraq's second-largest city, in June 2014, a geopolitical earthquake that apparently took the Obama administration and much of the world completely by surprise? The point is that events are unfolding so rapidly and unpredictably in today's Middle East, and the West's response is so weak, disjointed, and muddled, that nothing is beyond the realm of possibility in the region, including an ISIS caliphate stretching well beyond its current borders. And as the Twin Cities terror pipeline shows, ISIS's influence is felt far beyond the Middle East. While the bulk of ISIS's soldiers hail from Syria and Iraq, at least a third of its ranks consist of foreign fighters who have flocked to the Islamic State caliphate from 80 countries around the world, including thousands from Europe and approximately 130 from the United States. Boasting fanatical adherents on six continents and flush with tons of cash, territory, and heavy weaponry, ISIS may very well go down as the most powerful and influential terrorist movement in history. It is already the richest, with an estimated overall worth of $2 billion. It is also the most brutal. a group of marauders unparalleled in Mesopotamia since the time of the Mongols, crucifying, raping, pillaging, and beheading their way across Iraq and Syria, and gleefully posting videos and pictures of the slaughter on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for their devoted followers worldwide to revel in. Old and young, male and female, Christians and Kurds, Yazidis and Shiites, none are immune to ISIS's savagery. Thanks to its sweeping gains in Iraq and Syria, and its recruitment of some 15,000 foreign fighters from every corner of the globe, ISIS has overtaken al-Qaeda, the group from which it was spawned, as the top jihadist organization on the planet. Think about it. Al-Qaeda has branches around the world and remains an extremely dangerous beast, but it controls no territory and cannot field a standing army. The genocidal terror group Hamas has run the tiny Gaza Strip into the ground, creating a miserable mini-Islamic emirate with little influence beyond its immediate neighborhood, outside of fundraising. The Taliban ruled the war-ravaged wasteland of Afghanistan for just 5 years, but only took the country even deeper, into the Stone Age. While al-Qaeda, Hamas, and the Taliban are all formidable in their own ways, particularly Hamas with its large rocket arsenal that can now reach every corner of Israel, none of them can match ISIS's lethal combination of funding, foot soldiers, territory, global reach, multimedia influence, and advanced weaponry. Further, all three of the previously named organizations have been around for years and absorbed heavy blows to their leadership and infrastructures. They have likely already hit their ceilings, whereas ISIS, in its current incarnation, only exploded, no pun intended, onto the world scene in 2013, yet has already risen to the top of the jihadi heap. The only entity comparable to ISIS is Hezbollah. The two terror heavyweights have battled each other in Syria and Iraq over the past few years as part of the ongoing Sunni-Shia strife sweeping the region. More on that in Chapter 8. With Hezbollah's top leader, Sheikh Hassan Nasrallah, warning, "The capabilities, numbers, and capacities available to ISIS are vast and large. This is what is worrying everyone, and everyone should be worried. This ISIS monster is growing and getting bigger." Unlike the Islamic State, Hezbollah's home base of southern Lebanon does not constitute a vast territory. But Hezbollah, essentially operating as a state within a state, does exert tremendous sway over the Lebanese government, and also wields a global terror network that is active on 6 continents. Most important, Hezbollah is sponsored by the state of Iran, which has supplied it with tens of thousands of rockets and advanced missiles. Hezbollah also boasts a well-trained paramilitary force that has battled both the Israeli military and Syrian rebels in ground engagements. Although, as we'll hear in later chapters, funds from Turkey, Qatar, and the Persian Gulf states have almost certainly fallen into its hands, ISIS, unlike Hezbollah, has no clear state sponsor behind it, but ISIS is a state sponsor of terrorism. The territory controlled by the Islamic State encompasses large chunks of northern and western Iraq, and eastern and northern Syria, from the outskirts of the Iraqi capital Baghdad to the periphery of Aleppo, Syria's largest city. Clearly, ISIS possesses the geographical expanse of a state, and it is beginning to build up other trappings of statehood as well, developing a sophisticated bureaucracy, issuing annual progress reports, minting its own currency, and even, reportedly, issuing its own Islamic State passports. It's also a good bet that, if left unchecked, the ISIS Caliphate, like other state sponsors of terrorism, will export terror beyond its borders very soon, quite possibly to a neighborhood near you. In fact, it has already exported terror, if only indirectly, in the form of Western sympathizers who have been inspired by ISIS to carry out solo lone wolf jihadi attacks in Canada, New York City, Australia, and Oklahoma. As for rockets and missiles, ISIS could begin to close a wide gap with Hezbollah by, for starters, seizing some of the Syrian regime's missiles and launching pads, a scenario that is certainly not outside the realm of possibility. ISIS actually showcased a captured Scud missile during a military parade in Raqqa in June 2014. It's unclear whether the Scud was of Syrian or Iraqi origin, and experts believe it was inoperable. Nevertheless, ISIS more than makes up for its deficiencies in surface-to-surface missiles with the other spoils it has seized in its victories over the Syrian and Iraqi militaries. The vast ISIS arsenal reportedly includes dozens of Soviet-made tanks, American-made armored Humvees, howitzers and other field artillery, Chinese-made field guns, anti-aircraft guns, shoulder-fired RPGs, rocket-propelled grenades, anti-tank missiles, untold bundles of machine guns and AK-47s. ISIS may also have older model Soviet MiG fighter jets in its possession. No match, obviously, for U.S. fighter jets, but enough to give ISIS the beginnings, at least, of an air force. Perhaps most alarming for U.S. officials is ISIS's reported use of advanced surface-to-air missiles, or MANPADS, man-portable air defense system, which can be used to shoot down not only American fighter jets currently flying over Syria and Iraq, but also civilian airliners. ISIS has even issued its foot soldiers a how-to guide on shooting down U.S. Apache helicopters using MANPADS. The bitter irony is that a sizable chunk of ISIS's arsenal was made in the United States. According to an extensive study by the London-based group Conflict Armament Research, Islamic State forces have captured significant quantities of U.S.-manufactured small arms and have employed them on the battlefield. Much of that haul was acquired when ISIS forces rolled into Mosul in June 2014. ISIS's conquest of Mosul, Iraq's second-largest city, rich in history and culture and home to nearly 2 million inhabitants, was an unprecedented event in the modern era of Islamic terrorism. Not only did ISIS jihadists seize Mosul's central bank and close to $500 million, but also, according to the Los Angeles Times, Iraqi government forces retreated en masse from the ISIS onslaught, leaving behind a military hardware bonanza, including the U.S.-made armored Humvees, as well as trucks, rockets, artillery pieces, rifles, ammunition, even a helicopter. Some of the seized materiel was old or otherwise non-functioning, but a lot was promptly put to use on the battlefield. Pictures of grinning Islamist warriors cruising in U.S. Humvees bedecked with white-on-black militant flags flooded the internet and became the signature image of the ISIS rampage. So much for the years of training and equipment and $25 billion in aid that the U.S. has invested in the Iraqi military, whose brave warriors ran for the hills at the first sight of a jihadi-filled pickup truck, all but gift-wrapping loads of U.S. military hardware for ISIS. The effects of this shameful retreat were profound and quickly reverberated elsewhere in Iraq. One senior Kurdish official lamented that ISIS took the weapon stores of the 2nd and 3rd Iraqi Army Divisions in Mosul, the 4th Division in Salah al-Din, the 12th Division in the areas near Kirkuk, and another division in Diyala. We're talking about armaments for 200,000 soldiers, all from the Americans. ISIS's seizure of a Saddam Hussein-era chemical weapons depot outside Baghdad in June 2014 may have given it access to rockets filled with sarin gas. 17 Obama administration officials downplayed the incident and said that any chemical materials still stored at the facility were likely unusable. But then, reports began flooding in about ISIS using chemical weapons, in the form of chlorine gas, against Iraqi security forces. Similarly, news that ISIS stole 88 pounds of uranium from Mosul University, also in June, was essentially dismissed by the UN's nuclear agency, which branded the materials low-grade and not high-risk. Until an alleged ISIS weapons maker, referring to himself as Muslim al-Britani, began boasting on Twitter that a radioactive device has entered somewhere in Europe, and that ISIS was in possession of a dirty bomb thanks to uranium taken from, you guessed it, Mosul University in June 2014, the same uranium the UN dismissed as low risk. Perhaps al-Britani was lying, and perhaps the uranium does indeed pose no threat. Whatever the case, the fact that ISIS, an organization that regularly engages in mass executions and has already attempted genocide against Iraqi Christians and Yazidis, is actively working to procure weapons of mass destruction is anything but a low-risk scenario. Exhibit A, Syria. Although the Assad regime, under pressure from the United States, has supposedly destroyed all of its declared chemical arsenal, Western intelligence officials are concerned that Assad still has a secret stash of undeclared chemical weapons, not to mention a biological weapons program. The ISIS jihadists who are continuing their advance in Syria would no doubt love to get their hands on these chemical and biological agents and do horrible things with them. In the meantime, ISIS has reportedly developed its own makeshift biological weapon in the form of scorpion bombs. According to the Daily Mail, militants fighting for the Islamic State in Iraq have unveiled bombs containing hundreds of live scorpions designed to spread fear among their enemies. Canisters packed with poisonous varieties of scorpion are being blasted into towns and villages, which explode on impact, scattering the scorpions and causing panic among the innocent local population. Whether through beheadings, torture, mass rape, or scorpions, ISIS seems prepared to make infidels' worst nightmares come true, and to relish every minute of it. So how did we get here? After all, a global movement that controls 35,000 square miles of prime Middle Eastern real estate, rakes in up to $3 million per day in revenue, much of it in the illicit oil trade, draws thousands of Westerners to its ranks, beheads American citizens, and pulls the United States back into the world's most tumultuous region, couldn't have just appeared overnight. Although if you were listening to the Obama administration from 2012 through the first half of 2014, you'd be forgiven for thinking so. Throughout the 2012 presidential campaign, President Obama continually trumpeted the death of Osama bin Laden while proclaiming that al-Qaeda was on the run and on the path to defeat, decimated, as the president asserted on the campaign trail, and on its heels. Even after al-Qaeda-linked terrorists attacked the U.S. consulate in Benghazi, Libya, on September 11, 2012, killing four Americans, including Ambassador J. Christopher Stevens, Obama doggedly stuck to his narrative that al-Qaeda was in its death throes. While the president was busy scoring political points and willfully misleading the American people about the nature of the Islamic terror threat, al-Qaeda was not contracting, but expanding, to the point where AQ and its affiliates and allies cover more geographical ground today than they did on 9/11, from the tribal regions of Pakistan to Somalia, Yemen, Syria, Iraq, Nigeria, Libya, Sinai, Europe, India, and the Sahara Desert region covering northern Mali and southern Algeria. Yes, jihadist organizations like al-Qaeda are on the run indeed, overrunning large areas of the Muslim world. None more so than ISIS. When ISIS roared into the city of Fallujah in western Iraq in January 2014 and declared it part of an Islamic state, you'd think that would have been a massive wake-up call for the Obama administration. Not only does Fallujah lie just 45 miles from the Iraqi capital of Baghdad. In 2004, U.S. forces had reclaimed the city, which had become the nerve center of an al-Qaeda-led insurgency, after two hellacious battles that were the bloodiest and costliest of the entire Iraq War. Over 100 American troops were killed and hundreds more wounded in brutal building-to-building fighting against Sunni terrorists. One can only imagine the agony that veterans of the Fallujah campaigns must have felt as they watched ISIS raise its black banner above a city they had fought so valiantly to liberate just a few years earlier. Talk about a bitter pill to swallow. President Obama, however, seemed completely unfazed. In an interview with the New Yorker magazine just a few days after ISIS had seized Fallujah in a jihadist takeover, rife with strategic and symbolic significance, the president dismissed the growing strength of al-Qaeda affiliates and offshoots such as, well, ISIS. The analogy we use around here sometimes, and I think is accurate, is if a JV team puts on Lakers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.